But it is happening.
What we're going to do is we're going to put our children's program in right after we do the lighting of the Advent candle. So right when you see that part of light one candle to watch for Messiah, we're going to have the children's program in right after that and before the opening hymn. All right? But I'll make an announcement, so we'll know. Because they are ready to go. A couple of other announcements that we have today is that Mark's going to try to do a Bible study after the service today. We'll try to get it as soon as we can after the service, maybe even at 4 after. But if not by 10:30, they'll be meeting up here. Poinsettia is still for sale downstairs for $10 each. Go ahead and sign up downstairs. Make the check out to Faith Lutheran Mission Church. And if you would like it in memory of someone, go ahead and put that in the slot to the right, down on the information table. Christmas Eve service coming up.
Yeah.
Here we go. So, December 24th at 4 p.m. See up on the screen there. We're going to have a candlelight service right here with lots of carols, reading of scripture, and a candlelight service. It's going to be a wonderful time. Put it on your calendars for 4 p.m. Next Sunday is New Member Sunday. So we already have 3 people who are interested in joining our happy family. So if anyone else is interested, go ahead and contact me and we'll get you signed up for next Sunday's service. That includes anyone who's watching us online too. We will do remote members as well. Go ahead and send me an email, text, Twitter, whatever. So let me know if you want to be part of us and we'll get you inside. All right, let's go ahead and start our service for today. We're going to start with our Advent reading, which is Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. Let me go ahead and read that to you. Talking about John the Baptist preparing the way, which is kind of our theme for today. Verse 1, in those days, John the Baptist came to the Judean wilderness and began preaching. His message was, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. The prophet Isaiah was speaking about John when he said, he is a voice shouting in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord's coming. Clear the road for him. We'll be singing out of the blue hymnal for Light One Candle to Watch for Messiah. It's hymn number 630, and we'll be singing verses 1 through 3. this is our awesome children's ministry director, Christine. She is incredible, and I am so proud of her. Thank you for all you've done for us and putting this all together.
Wait a second here. I'd like to welcome you all to our third annual Christmas program in Sunday School. It's called The First Christmas Night and it's written by Keith Christopher. "'Twas the very first Christmas when all through the town not a creature was stirring, there was not a sound. The moon shining bright in the heavens so high gave the luster of midday to the Bethlehem sky. The animals were nestled in warm, cozy places with looks of contentment on each of their faces. And Mary and Joseph, so tired from the road, had just settled into a humble abode. To a Bethlehem stable, they traveled with care. They knew that their baby soon would be there. And then in the stable, baby's first cry, peace on earth, goodwill, redemption is nigh. He had not a crib, but in a manger instead, the tiny new baby laid down his sweet head. Mary looked down at his cute little nose and silently counted 10 fingers, 10 toes. As shepherds kept watch on a small herd nearby hill, their sheep were all silent and sleepy and still. When suddenly, in the sky, there rose such a sight, one angel, then many, appeared in the night. The heavens rejoiced as their story unfurled. A baby, a savior, had been born to the world. So shepherds arose to search for the place to get a close look at a baby's sweet face. Then out of the east, there came royalty, whose mission was finding the savior, you see. When they finally found the babe, they had sought. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh were the gifts they brought. So the wise men bowed down and praised his sweet name. Soon all those who heard would rejoice that he came. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Isaiah 9:6. And now we that know can say with delight, Jesus was born on the first Christmas night.
Oh, gifts of Christmas is hope. We cannot buy hope, but hope is given to us as a free Christmas gift by Jesus. Because Jesus came on this holy night and because he was willing to lay down his life, we get the hope of a lifetime in heaven with Jesus.
Another gift of Christmas is joy. We feel joy because Jesus is with us. We feel joy in the love of our families, friends, neighbors, church, and Sunday school. Joy in the air and Christmas time.
Like August, we need to accept the gift of peace. We all want peace in the world, our towns, and families. Jesus brings the Christmas gift of peace.
And the greatest of all gifts is love. God loves us so much that he sent Jesus, that we may have life forever. Jesus tells us to love one another as he has loved us.
We wish you the wonderful gifts of Christmas that Jesus brings us. Merry Christmas.
Joyful.
secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in our sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of Lutheran congregations and mission for Christ, and by God's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Good morning.
We've already had a pretty good reading this morning, brought to us by the younger members of the congregation. And that's something that we really appreciate. And we thank God for that. The first reading today comes from Zephaniah, chapter 3, beginning with verse 14 through verse 20. Another minor prophet, bringing once again the message of God, pretty much the same as other minor prophets have done, warning about the sin and the corruption taking place in the nation of Israel, but ending with the promise of the good things to come, and which Christ always seems to have that for us, even though we do not deserve it. He seems to be there with it to help us through the tough times. Beginning at verse 14. Sing, O daughter of Zion, shout aloud, O Israel. Be glad and rejoice with all your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. For the Lord will remove his hand of judgment and will disperse the armies of your enemy. And the Lord himself, the King of Israel, will live among you. At last your troubles will be over. You will never again fear disaster. On that day, the announcement to Jerusalem will be, cheer up, Zion, don't be afraid. For the Lord your God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears. He will rejoice over you with joyful songs. I will gather you who mourn for the appointed festivals. You will be disgraced no more. I will deal severely with all who have oppressed you. I will save the weak and helpless ones. I will bring together those who were chased away. I will give glory and fame to my former exiles, wherever they have been mocked and shamed. On that day, I will gather you together and bring you home again. I will give you a good name, a name of distinction among all the nations of the earth, as I restore your fortunes before their very eyes. I, the Lord, have spoken. The psalm for today is Psalm 85, found in your green hymnal on page 254, or you may read it on the screen. I will read the odd verses if you will read the even. You have been gracious to your land, O Lord. You have restored the good fortunes of Judah.
You have forgiven the iniquity of your people and blotted out all their sins.
You have withdrawn all your fury and turned yourself from your wrathful indignation.
Restore us then, O God, our Savior. Let your anger depart from us.
Will you be displeased with us forever? Will you prolong your anger from age to age?
Will you not give us life again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation.
I will listen to what the Lord God is saying, for he is speaking peace to his faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to him.
Truly, his salvation is very near to those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land.
Mercy and truth have been together. Righteousness and peace have been together.
Truth shall spring up from the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven.
The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase.
Righteousness shall go before him, and peace shall be a pathway for his feet. The second lesson is found in Philippians chapter 4, beginning with verse 4 through 7. Always be full of joy in the Lord. Say it again, rejoice. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand.
His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Here ends the second reading. Please rise as you are able for the gospel.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke in the 7th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Starting in verse 18. The disciples of John the Baptist told John about everything Jesus was doing. So John called for two of his disciples, and he sent them to the Lord to ask him, "Are you the Messiah we've been expecting? Or should we keep looking for someone else?" John's two disciples found Jesus and said to him, "John the Baptist sent us to ask, 'Are you the Messiah we've been expecting, or should we keep looking for someone else?'" At that very time, Jesus cured many people of their diseases, illnesses, and evil spirits, and he restored sight to many who were blind. Then he told John's disciples, "Go back to John and tell him what you have seen and heard. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised to life, and the good news is being preached to the poor. And tell him, God blesses those who do not turn away because of me." After John's disciples left, Jesus began talking about him to the crowds. "What kind of man did you go into the wilderness to see? Was he a weak reed, swayed by every breath of wind? Or were you expecting to see a man dressed in expensive clothes? No, people who wear beautiful clothes and live in luxury are found in palaces. Were you looking for a prophet? Yes, and he is more than a prophet. John is the man to whom the scriptures refer when they say, 'Look, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, and he will prepare your way before you.' I tell you, of all who have ever lived, none is greater than John. Yet, even the least person in the kingdom of God is greater than he is." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. So did any of you have any big plans this Christmas season that maybe didn't turn out the way you expected? Almost always there's a hope inside of us each year when we unpack the Christmas boxes and start decorating our houses. Maybe this year will be the year that everything goes exactly according to plan. However, Murphy's Law always seems to come into play, and those plans just don't work out. The tree's too big, or someone put the turkey in the oven and forgot to turn the oven on. Maybe you can't find your favorite ornament. Maybe you're disappointed about a family member who can't come over, or the church doesn't schedule the Christmas Eve service to match your schedule. There's so many ways for Advent and Christmas plans to get messed up, it's not even funny. And you know what I'm going to say? Good. That's right, good. I can't think of a better Advent and Christmas lesson for us to learn than what we learn in those moments when things just don't go the way we expect. Or when our plans don't work out the way we wanted. It really is a good thing. Because Christmas isn't supposed to be about celebrations of wants and wishes, or even our best laid plans. Christmas is about the celebration of a very real Jesus, who was born into a very real world. And this Jesus who was born to us does his ministry in ways that often surprise us, sometimes confuses us, and even frustrates us at times. So it's good for us to be shaken out of our self-focus and be confronted by a God who has his very own ways and methods, even though we don't always understand those ways. So, doesn't that put you all in the Christmas spirit? Now, you might be thinking, preacher, you're not supposed to talk this way at this time of year. But here's the deal, folks. We can't get around it. Everything I have just said is written right there in the gospel lesson. And we have to talk about it. John the Baptist and the things he said can't be avoided. Not last week, and not this week either. But before we talk about this particular passage, let's go back and talk a little about who John the Baptist was. First off, he's not a Baptist. Actually, he's not a Lutheran. However, he was a guy of whom the prophets had been foretelling many centuries before. And the prophet Isaiah predicts about John in chapter 40, verse 3, when the prophet says this, "Listen, it's the voice of someone shouting, 'Clear the way through the wilderness for the Lord. Make a straight highway through the wasteland for our God.'" This is the voice of whom Isaiah is speaking, who would come prepare the way for people's hearts to receive the Messiah. Now, an angel of God also said this about John in Luke chapter 1, verses 15 through 17. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even before his birth. And he will turn many Israelites to the Lord their God. He will be a man with spirit and the power of Elijah. He will prepare the people for the coming of the Lord. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children. And he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the godly. So John the Baptist had a mission from God himself. And when the time comes, he explodes onto the scene like a stick of lit dynamite. John goes out into the wilderness and preaches a fiery message of repentance and judgment. And because John is wielding a Holy Spirit power, people come out of the woodwork to see him. Thousands repent of their sins and are baptized in the Jordan River. The highway for the promised Messiah was being prepared. Then one day, Jesus comes to John to be baptized. Luke chapter 3, verse 21 says this, "One day when the crowds were being baptized, Jesus himself was baptized. As he was praying, the heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit in bodily form descended on him like a dove. And a voice from heaven said, 'You are my dearly loved son, and you bring me great joy.'" And with that declaration from his heavenly Father, the ministry of Jesus begins. The long-anticipated activity of the long-awaited promised Messiah has finally arrived. However, something strange then happens. This Jesus, this Messiah, doesn't do things the way anyone would have expected God's chosen one to do. Now, the first thing Jesus does is disappear into the wilderness for 40 days. This is important, as Jesus is fasting and facing the temptation of Satan himself. Then Jesus starts preaching in his hometown. However, the people there reject him and even try and kill him. But there are also some wonderful moments as well. Jesus begins to heal people and preach in other synagogues, and soon great crowds were following him. And just when it looks like Jesus' ministry could really take off, he goes and chooses some very odd people to be his disciples. Fishermen, tax collectors, and other people like that. So it had to be kind of frustrating for John the Baptist to be seeing all of this. According to any kind of worldly standards, Jesus' ministry was hardly a blazing comet of success. There were ups and downs and unexpected twists and some very odd decisions. And then, to make matters worse, John finds himself in jail, with his only crime being to speak the truth. We read about this in Mark chapter 6, verses 17 through 18. For Herod had sent soldiers to arrest and imprison John as a favor to Herodias. She had been his brother Philip's wife, but Herod had married her. John had been telling Herod, "It is against God's law for you to marry your brother's wife." So John goes from preaching to the masses, seeing thousands of people confessing their sins and being baptized, and even seeing the start of the ministry of Jesus, and now he's in jail. It looked like everything was going exactly according to plan for a while. However, as John sits in prison, he starts asking some serious questions. We can hear it in the questions. He sends a couple of guys to ask Jesus in our gospel text for today in verse 19. Are you the Messiah we've been expecting? Or should we keep looking for someone else? Two very simple questions. You can hear the hurt, the heartbreak, and the utter disappointment in John's words. You can almost hear John the Baptist asking, Jesus, what's going on here? It isn't supposed to be like this. This is so uncomfortable for us, isn't it? If you were going to make up a story about a promised Messiah who would come and save the world, you wouldn't include something like this. But that's just it. That's why these questions of John are so important. Because this really did happen, and John really asked these questions. And these questions are sometimes the kinds of questions maybe you may ask yourself when life gets difficult. Maybe right now, some of you are asking questions like, God, what are you doing? God, how can this be happening to me or to my loved ones or to the world? Maybe you're thinking, God, I'm not sure how long I can hold on. It's not supposed to be like this. Maybe you too are asking, God, do I need to start looking somewhere else for hope? And what's your reaction when these questions come to mind or even maybe out of your mouth? Do you become afraid of what God will say and get, maybe he'll get angry? Do you think that maybe a true Christian shouldn't have these questions, but should just stifle the hurt and put on a happy face? If so, I have news for you. It's okay to have questions. Yeah, Spencer agrees. It's okay to be upset with God and to struggle with him. It's okay to say that you're disappointed and that your faith is struggling at times. It's okay. God can handle it. Let's take a look at how Jesus answered these faith questions from John. Now first, Jesus redirects John's attention to all the ways in which the work of the promised Messiah is happening when he says this in verses 21 through 23. At that very time, Jesus cured many people of their diseases, illnesses, and evil spirits. And he restored sight to many who were blind. Then he told John's disciples, "Go back to John and tell him what you have seen and heard. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised to life, and the good news is being preached to the poor. And tell him, God blesses those who do not turn away because of me." Now the Greek word used here for turn away is the word skandalizo, which means to cause to stumble. Jesus is having the messengers tell John, Hang in there, John. Look what we've accomplished already. Don't start stumbling from what you know is true in your heart. So this brings up a question for us. How often do we neglect to notice the wonders of what God is doing right in front of our eyes? So often we tend to focus on what we feel God is not doing for us, rather than remembering what He has already done for us. And then we then challenge God to our own plans, according to our own plans, instead of thanking Him for His plan of salvation. And we sometimes get angry with God for not taking care of our wants for the present, instead of thanking Him for securing a future of eternity in heaven without concerns or pain or disappointments. But that's okay. It's okay. God understands. And He still loves us. Well, the next thing we need to realize is how Jesus speaks of John. Now, even after hearing these questions of a doubt of faith, even after John openly asks some tough questions and admits that he is struggling in his faith, but notice that Jesus doesn't love John any less or think of him in any kind of disdain. In fact, Jesus has high regard for his servant. Listen to how Jesus describes John to the crowd around him in verses 26 through 28. Were you looking for a prophet? Yes, and he is more than a prophet. John is the man to whom the scriptures refer when they say, "Look, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, and he will prepare your way before you." I tell you, of all who have ever lived, none is greater than John. Yet even the least person in the kingdom of God is greater than he is. These verses should be a great comfort for people who have real struggles with God. We may have doubts, and we may have real questions, and we may have to do some real wrestling with God because of our faith doubts and the plans he has for us. However, this never, ever changes how God feels about us or how much He loves us. And these feelings we may sometimes have will also never affect His willingness to fulfill the promises He made for us, to be forgiven and to be with His, in His house with Him forever. God doesn't have doubts or questions, or struggles when it comes to all of you. You see, folks, God answered the questions, does God care? Does God love me? He answered those questions on the cross. God's love for us is so deep that He sent His one and only Son to this earth as a baby that first Christmas morning. God's love for us is so strong that His one and only Son willingly died on the cross for us as a sacrifice for our sins. If John the Baptist had prepared the way for this promised Messiah, even though John struggled with deep faith questions and was uncertain, really uncertain at times of God's plan, these doubts still didn't stop Jesus from loving him. And it doesn't stop Jesus from loving us when we have our struggles of faith. God sent Jesus, His one and only Son, here to this world on that first Christmas for us. An angel from heaven declares this in Luke chapter 2, verses 10 through 11. Scripture says this, "But the angel reassured them. 'Don't be afraid,' he said. 'I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. So when Jesus died on the cross, he died for John, and he died for all of us. Jesus died for people with struggles, and he died for people with doubts. And Jesus died for people who have moments of weak faith and disappointments. And remember this, folks. With his resurrection, Jesus shows us that there will be a time when none of our questions matter, when we will never again know disappointments or lack of faith or have any reason for doubts. In the meantime, go ahead and ask. Go ahead and struggle. Go ahead and be honest with God. His love for you, his plan for you, and his forgiveness of your sins won't change a bit. And that is our blessed hope this and every Christmas season. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the ultimate Christmas gift of you sending your son Jesus here to this world to be with us, to live with us, know us, and then to sacrifice himself for us as the atoning substitute for all of our sins. Lord, we also thank you that you love us so much that you're willing to hear and understand all of our disappointments, which we shout out to you in anguish, and for which you then wrap your loving arms around us to give us peace and strength. Thank you, Lord. And we pray this in the holy name of your Son, Jesus, whom we celebrate the birth of this Christmas season as the reason for the season. Amen. Our next hymn is Your Little Ones, Dear Lord. We're still in the green hymnal yet, number 52.
Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit.
and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended into hell.
On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, come to us. Fill us with strength and joy that is within your Son, Jesus. Lord, we're bombarded by all the stuff and the media, and we're not seeing the true reason for the season, which is keeping Christ in Christmas. Lord, help us to stand strong on this Christmas season, to make it not just the happy holidays, but truly a merry Christmas. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for a number of people who are on our hearts and minds at this time in need of your healing touch. Father God, there's a number of people here today, who are walking miracles, Lord. And I know there's still miracles yet to happen in this congregation. So, Lord, we pray for your Jehovah Rapha to come on down and touch all of those people with your healing touch who are on our hearts and minds at this time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for healing of this nation. Lord, we've turned away from you, Lord. So as a congregation, Lord, we promise to pray for our nation's leaders and this whole nation, that we turn back to you, Lord, because we know you promise in your word that if we do turn from our wicked ways, you will hear our prayer and heal this land. So we stand on that promise, Lord. As we stand on all your promises in Scripture, Lord, help us to be able to stand strong in praying for this nation's and its leaders. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for all those soldiers fighting for those freedoms we enjoy here. Protect them, Lord. Keep them safe, Lord. Bring them home, Lord. Reunite them with their families. And Lord God, help us as a nation to stand by them as they stood by for us. Help them to transition back into society with jobs. Help them with their healing, whether that's in body, mind, or spirit. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for all those soldiers fighting on the front lines for your gospel truth. All those missionaries that we support individually and as a congregation, Lord God, protect them. Protect their health, Lord, and the health of their families. Protect them from any kind of human evil or evil of Satan. Lord God, please provide them with the resources that they need to answer that calling you have placed on each of their hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
If there's anyone who has any prayers that they'd like to make at this time, please go ahead and say that. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the mercy of your Son, Jesus, our Lord. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share that peace of God with one another. Words that our Lord Jesus has taught us.
Who went to heaven?
Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses.
As we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation. But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom. And the power. And the glory. Forever and ever.
Please rise as you are able for the benediction. And may the Lord bless you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord shine his face upon you and give you his everlasting strength, hope, peace, love, and joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And we're off. Thanks again, kids, for an awesome program. Have a wonderful time down there. The rest of us children of God have got one more hymn to sing. We're still working out of the green hymnal yet. Number 60, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Thanks be to God.